Muscles, use it or lose it. Why should you know about the muscles in your body and why it's important for you to know a little bit more about them? So essentially, our bodies consist of a framework which is consisting of a skeleton of bones and muscles which are responsible for movement. Muscles are also associated with ligaments and tendons. These tendons help the muscles attach to bones. So when you have a muscle which is attached at two ends to bones, when the muscle contracts, it brings one bone towards the other. So for example, my biceps muscle is attached on top to my shoulder and down to my forearm. So when I contract my biceps, my forearm moves towards my arm. So that is contraction. There's also something known as relaxation, where the muscle relaxes. So when I'm contracting my biceps, the antagonistic muscle at the back of my arm, known as the triceps, has to relax to enable my biceps to contract. When I'm extending my arm, my triceps has to contract and my biceps has to reciprocally relax. So these are known as a group of agonistic and antagonistic muscles because they have opposing actions. Now, from an evolutionary point of view, human beings went from being four-legged animals to two-legged animals, primarily so that it could free up their upper limbs to carry objects. And we are evolutionarily built to be endurance machines which can carry things. Although that's how we were evolutionarily developed, we have ended up becoming very sedentary individuals sitting in front of a desk, in front of a computer, and exercising our brains more than our muscles. In our bodies, we have three different types of muscles. We have what is called the smooth muscle, or otherwise known as the involuntary muscle, which is the muscle that lines our stomach, our intestines, our airways, and so on. And these are not under our conscious control. Then we have the cardiac muscle, which is something that is constantly working all the time. And we have skeletal muscle, which is the bulk of all our muscles, which is under our volitional control, which is something we can contract and relax. Within this, if we were to subdivide and look at each muscle fiber, we have essentially three types of muscle fibers. We have what is called the type 1 muscle fiber, the type 2A muscle fiber, and the type 2X muscle fiber. The type 1 muscle fiber is an endurance muscle fiber. These are fibers that can contract for a very long period of time using aerobic energy. When I say aerobic energy, means it is converting glucose using oxygen, in the presence of oxygen, to produce ATP, which is the energy currency of the cell. ATP is known as adenosine triphosphate, which is what provides energy to our muscles to contract. Now, it's surprising, but every muscle cell contains over a billion molecules of ATP. And the production of ATP during exercise can sometimes go up even 10 to 12 fold. So it's absolutely astonishing about how much ATP we need and how much can be produced for our muscles to contract. Coming back to the types of muscle fibers, we have type 1, which is the endurance fibers. Type 2A is, so endurance fibers are also known as slow twitch fibers. Type 2A is known as the fast twitch fibers, which are something that contract immediately when we need a burst of energy. Let's say that we're trying to sprint or we're trying to run away from a danger. At that time, you need a sudden burst of energy. And that's when your type 2A muscle fibers come into play. And they rely on a different energy system known as the phosphocreatine system. Now, this is something that's stored in our muscles ready for use. So it doesn't need, because we don't have time to produce energy in an emergency situation. So it's already available in the form of phosphocreatine. And this phosphocreatine donates a phosphate ion to ADP, converting it into ATP, which is readily produced and is usable by the muscle to use it for the sake of energy. The third type of muscle fibers are the type 2X muscle fibers, which are also fast twitch, but they use a different type of energy system known as the glycolytic system or the anaerobic system. So that's a system where we use glucose, but in the absence of oxygen. So that ends up producing a byproduct known as lactate or hydrogen ions, which is what causes the burn in your muscles when you exercise too much. So these are the three types of muscle fibers that are known to exist in human beings. Now, the important thing that we all need to realize that as we age, we start losing muscle mass. This is known as age-related sarcopenia. And this is one of the main hallmarks of rapid aging. So if someone was to be aging out of proportion to their chronological age, you would find that their muscle mass would have significantly reduced. By and large, age-related sarcopenia occurs at a rate of about 1% per year after the age of 40. So by the time you're 70, if you've not been doing anything to prevent age-related sarcopenia, you would have lost approximately 30% of your muscle mass, which is a devastating number. In addition to that, there is something known as age-related loss of muscle strength and muscular endurance. That's even more than 1% per year after the age of 40, sometimes even 2 to 3% per year, which is also very astonishing because age-related loss of muscle strength is a critical factor in the aging population, particularly when we're talking about things such as falls at home, which can precipitate life-threatening situations such as hip fractures, vertebral fractures, head injuries, and so on. So how do we prevent age-related sarcopenia? One of the ways, of course, is to get into a program of regular strength training at least twice, preferably thrice a week, where you are under the supervision of a strength coach, where you're exercising various parts of your body, various muscles. So it's important to focus on all types of muscles, including your spinal muscles, your core muscles, lower limb, upper limb, chest, back, triceps, biceps, etc. And focusing on a program which does not injure you, which uses a concept known as progressive overload, so that you're constantly stimulating your muscles to remain strong and grow bigger. And this is one of the ways that we can, to some extent, reduce the effects of aging on our bodies. Another important thing that I'd like to point out is something known as eccentric strength. Now, when I pick up a load, if I'm picking up a dumbbell in my arm and flexing it by using my biceps, I can either let that weight fall very quickly to the floor or towards the floor by just allowing gravity to pull me down, or I can control the rate at which I allow that weight to come down. So that strength which I use to control the descent of that weight is known as eccentric strength. And that is one of the most important factors that prevents us from falling, especially as we age. So when you're stepping off a curb or you're getting down the stairs, you're able to control the rate at which you're descending without losing balance and stability. That will prevent you from falling. So when you get into a strength training program, it's important that you focus not only on concentric, which is the contraction, but also on the relaxation phase, which is known as eccentric strength. Now, an exercise program must also include my favorite 45 minutes, four times a week of zone 2 to keep your cardiovascular system in good health. So remember to focus on your muscles as you age, because you either use it or you lose it.